Big Boy's Big Neighborhood. Boy. All right, it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, man. And it's always good to have this man in the neighborhood, man. D-Smoke in the neighborhood with us.
He's our friend. Yes.
Hey, man, we were talking about this off air as well. Your energy, bro. You know what I'm saying? Like, you guys got this energy that is just amazing, you know? And it's like, it's a warm energy. And as much as I try to penetrate and mess that up for you, you never get off your square with that, bro.
Oh, man, we got to play it close to the cuff, man.
Do you levitate?
Yes.
It seemed like you just get somewhere and just start to levitate a little bit.
Just hover.
And what I want to say before we do anything, bro, is I want to get you back in the neighborhood very soon. Because I want to get you in after we hear the album.
Cool.
You know, and when he came in, I was like, man, you really going to have us wait?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you
know, and he could have gave it to us. But
Black Habits.
But hey, wait, hold on. Time out. Before we continue, is my mic still on?
Yeah.
Okay, for sure. Oh, I played you some of the project last time we came through.
Really?
You know, months back. You got the exclusive.
Early.
Remember,
I'm talking.
Remember, we cut the cameras off and the mics off.
But did we get married to it?
No, you
did
didn't
you
get
give
married.
It to us? Like,
nah, we
like
didn't.
I wanted to sit down and next time we sit, I want to
quote
lyrics. Why this?
You
know, because I think that the way that you get down, Smoke, is I want to have this journey through the album.
Absolutely.
You know, because I know you're not wasting words.
No.
I know you're not wasting talent. You're not just like, oh, I'll put this on there. So I'm ready for a whole different energy project, bro.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Now, why the title Black Habits?
Okay, so it's called Black Habits because it's somewhat of a journey through my family's experience with, you know, drug addiction, incarceration, you know, pops coming home, redemption, you know. And so, it's that journey, and it's the good and the bad. It's a celebration of blackness and all that it is, you know, for me, you know, from my perspective. So I was rolling with my nephew, and the way my projects come together, we have a lot of music prior to we decide what the name is, right? It's not like we go in like, okay, I'm going to market it like this. Now let's make some music.
This is the title. Mm-hmm. All right, we got to fill it in now.
Yeah, exactly. No, we've made so many songs, and when I sat back and realized, because I had another title in mind, I sat back and realized, I was like, oh, shoot, this is a darker project. And not darker in a sense like it's depressing, but it's just like a deeper, you know, a full project. And I was actually with my nephew, who's 15. He goes to Inglewood High. And I was like, man, I want to call it Black something. Like, just it's. And this is before we knew we were going to release it during Black History Month.
Wow.
He knows the music. And those are the people I kind of consult when I'm trying to bring my thoughts together. And the first thing he said, literally, and it's my nephew Ricardo, he was like, Black Habits. I was like, Black Habits?
Damn.
You're a genius. You know what I'm saying? Like,
that's it.
Like, and the interesting thing is my other nephew did something similar when I had written a book, and that's gonna come out sometime later. And you know, the main character of that book is named Isaiah. And I was like, man, this, you know, it's this kid named Isaiah, vivid imagination, this, that, and the other. He was like, vivid Isaiah.
Damn. You need to bring your nephews over
these
here.
Kids, man, you know. So.
Hey, man, but yeah, you got to tap in. You know what I love about that, too, man, is that you accept the energy.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? No matter where it's coming from, because you got to have where you got to listen to others. Tap into the young, your elders, whoever it may be, bro. And it's crazy that you tapped in. Now, me personally, I wouldn't have told the story that it came from my nephew.
Right. I would have said, I did it.
That would have been like, man, I was just rolling. I'm looking around. I was like, man, Black Habits. But, you know, you're a totally different individual than I am. Is it a little different going in now? Do you feel like with Black Habits, when you say it's dark, but it's not like depressingly dark?
Right.
Is it more, do you feel like you open yourself even more so, like peeled off more layers with the album?
Absolutely. And when I say it's dark, but not depressingly dark, it's like, it's that type of like, depth that's real inspirational, right? And not inspirational because it's like, you can do this, just keep going. Like, there's none of that, really. You know, it's just, this is where we come from. So people know the story already. They know how it concludes. They've watched the Netflix thing, so we're giving them the backstory.
Mm-hmm.
And in doing that, it's like, it's inspirational. You get that depth. And then, you know, musically, we connected with the right people to be able to do it and never compromise how enjoyable you can just make music, you know. DJ Battlecat has one of my favorite songs. Him and Lawrence from 1500 have one of my favorite songs on the project.
Which is
Sunkissed Child.
Oh, what is your favorite?
Oh, my goodness. When you hear that chord progression, It's just the one Battle Cat got on the talk box and it just made this West Coast moment. And the progression was Lawrence's, and then Battle Cat just built, you know, composed this thing around it. And it has that West Coast sound that, you know, it's just the music is there. And so that was one of those. When I got with Battle Cat, I'm thinking, you know, I want one of them, you know, bangers that I'm gonna. And it still got that feeling, but you know, you can never predetermine what you're gonna connect on.
But that's
what
I love about you, Smoke, is we can't figure you out.
Man,
you know what I'm saying? Even just watching Rhythm and Flow or when you listen to your project, it's just like we think you're going in one direction, and then it's like that's why it's like a musical journey that you give to us, man. And that's why I can't wait to actually have Black Habits like in my hand. You know what I'm saying? In my headphones.
On your Instagram, you shared a bunch of like pictures and different things. Was the album inspired by these different pictures that you showed? Something that really caught my eye was a letter that you wrote to the judge, and it says, and it was marked November 3rd, 1992. It says, "Dear Judge Smith, I'm writing this letter because I miss my dad, but I know he did something bad," already rhyming. "But I know he won't do it again because he loves me. Please give him a chance. Thank you. Daniel, second grade."
Yeah.
That was a real letter because it's
real stamped. Real life, yeah.
How did you get that back?
That's one of those things I didn't realize my mom had archived. And so literally I saw that like 2 weeks ago. So that's something that we, you know, our team, we're on the fly. We'll call it audible. Like, you know, the people need this. This completes the story, you know, and this is evidence that we're coming from that real place. So when I saw that, I was like, oh, you know, I already had the plan to release the pictures, like Pops and his three sons, you know, locked up. Even the family portrait, which is the album artwork, is a visit. You know, it's not, it looks like this happy Black family, but people who know can look at my dad's outfit and be like,
we know.
That's visiting day.
That's visiting day.
Yeah,
you
man.
Know, and all that joy is just the joy of, man, we actually get to see you in person. This is not, everything is perfect.
Is that something that you have to come, like go with your dad and be like, is this okay for us to share with the world?
You know what? I don't, because as people, my mom and dad are so open with their story, their testimony. Mm-hmm. Like they're the people who, like, they're both ministers. Mm-hmm. So naturally when they reach out to people, their biggest tool to like actually connect with people is like their story. Cause people tend to put them on that pedestal too. Mm-hmm. They're like from the outside looking in, it's the ideal Black family. You got these musical sons that are doing stuff, graduating, having kids and all this good stuff. And then you got both parents in the household. So people are like, man, the Ferris is the Gouchers. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, they never hold back that story, which is like, hey, no, this is what the late 80s and early 90s looked like for us. You know what I'm saying? And then into the 2000s, we had our own different set of struggles, you know. And that's when, you know, Chuck, this is when I connected, when I was, you know, being a young entrepreneur in the city of Inglewood, making ends meet and investing in myself, you know, before the degree of publicity we had. So it's always dope to share that backstory when people tend to see you and be like, man, you know, you got it figured out.
Right.
It's like, always have
it's a lot of tuition into the school of experience or the life experience.
Yes.
That's crazy, man. And Chuck, I even asked Chuck before you came in, I said, man, what's y'all history? How long have y'all known each other? And you said it's been, what, over a decade?
Easy 10 years. Yeah. Easy 10 years. Yeah, man. They literally had their studio, Woodworks, they had the studio right down the street from where one of our studios was. So literally after we would record or do the broadcast, what we were doing, me and DJ Head, we would go over to whatever, doing the jam sessions.
Did you ever feel like with Smoke that it was those moments where it was almost about to happen? Oh, man, it's happening.
Yeah, no, absolutely, because you see it. And the thing is, what I love about his story and their story as far as a family, it's always been that. So I love the celebration at this point. We've seen the dark moments. We've seen them, you know, attempting and building and building and getting their things off the ground. But to see the celebration, to see, you know, moms and pops and, you know, everybody a part of it, that's the thing that I'm most proud, because we knew it was going to happen eventually.
Right.
Yeah. But the fact that it's happening on his time, on their time, and the family
and the
world.
And the way that you're doing it too, man, without the compromise. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're doing it. I love that you do it your way. you know, and how talented you guys are, bro. Like, extremely. You know, and no disrespect to the game, but there's just the game now is like, you know, you get in. It's not even where you fit in. You just get in on top of each other. And
right, right.
So when you get something that has a more of a core to it, you just enjoy it more. And even just watching on Rhythm and Flow, right? Just watching where you would go with that. Not loving the person because you got the story too, but the way that you took the story and the way that you put it into song.
Creatively, yeah.
Creatively amazing, bro. They told me about this one joint that you got with Snoop.
Yep.
Yeah. So that's what I'm talking about.
Gaspar like Younga? Is that how you pronounce
Gaspar
that?
Gaspar Younga, yeah.
Gaspar Younga.
So Gaspar Younga is the name of a general who... was in a town near Veracruz in Mexico. He's of African descent, and he successfully fought off a Spanish invasion in that area in Mexico. And so it's this place where you still, to this day, find plenty black people in Mexico.
Thank you.
And so I think it's one of those untold stories. You know, I don't think you find that one in the history books. You kind of got to know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they still have monuments of him in that area to this day. So it's like...
Have you been there?
I have not been
but
there.
But you will, huh?
I will. I need
now
to.
Now you have to.
I have to, right?
I mean, you have a song about it.
I've been to Puerto Viejo, Puerto Limon in Costa Rica, where it's like a grip of black people on the Caribbean side of Costa Rica, you know. So I've seen this like strong African presence in Central America. And I think so many people are still surprised when they see a black man speaking Spanish. They're still like, oh, shoot.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That's because a lot of people really, like you said, don't know and haven't explored outside and don't see it. Like when you go to Colombia, when you go to Cuba, when you go to Costa Rica, even in Mexico, there are all over. There is plenty. And I just think that it's, again, exposure. People just really don't know.
Right. But absolutely.
It's educating.
That's real.
Now,
and I don't mention his name not once in the song. By the way, it's not like I'm not on the song like back in Veracruz there was a black dude.
Yeah. Take a journey with me. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, now we know this is edutainment.
No, it's not even that.
I love this.
I'm actually that's the song where I'm acting up the most. You know what I'm saying? And so. In the way
emperor
that
stuff.
You said what?
Yeah, I said you're on your emperor shit.
Exactly,
on that one.
Exactly. In the way that you would. Kind of summon that energy of like, okay, we taking over, you know.
Is it easier to get like a feature or easier to get things done now since the win? And you know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. You know, I believe that the true price for a feature, because people hit you up like, how much you charge for a feature, you know? And there were times when I did that too, like, hey man, what's up? I need a feature, thinking that would get me somewhere, not knowing. And it wasn't until Sir signed to TDE that he told me like, bro, you my brother, I can do a feature with you now, but believe you me, it's not gonna do what you imagine it's gonna do. That one feature is not gonna change your platform, right? The price for a feature should be mutually beneficial. When I have this group of people who follows me devoutly, and then you have that group of people, then it becomes an exchange of our artistry, of the people that love and follow us. And it raises both of our you know, stature in the game, right?
Not a help me, help me.
Not a help me.
Yeah, you know, help me, man.
And not only that, it might give you an immediate look, but then it also puts you in a position where to everybody who hears that song, you look like the young homie on there.
Right.
Right.
A lot of people, a hard introduction sometimes to shake too.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes, because then you've kind of put a cap on yourself, like, oh, he's that person's little. You know what I'm saying?
Speaking of features, you have Ari Lennox on for Real Body. How did that come together?
You know what? I wrote the song Real Body just before I went on Rhythm and Flow. Mm-hmm. And this producer named Beast from London, who produced Classic Man for Jadena, he's super dope. I wrote a verse and a hook to Real Body. And it's super mellow. And I kind of tapped into that. Just writer energy. I didn't know what I was going to do with the song, but this is one of two songs on there where I'm more singing than rapping. And once I got through the hook, I was like, okay, you know, the content, the basic content of Real Body is like appreciating a woman in spite of her flaws and all of that, you know, appreciating the flaws themselves, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so, but of course, one of the lines is that's your real body. And that's somewhat controversial in the sense that some women are like, you know, I have complete agency over my body. If I want to enhance it, that's my choice, right? And I'm not,
and that's true.
It's not mainly, it is. Mm-hmm. It's not a commentary on that, but I knew that some people would take it as such. So I felt like the proper thing to do would be to get a woman on there who's celebrating herself.
Yes.
You know? And so I just held on to it for some time. And one time I was on Instagram and Ari Lennox goes live and she's going up.
She loves to go live.
I check in because I'm like, oh, it's going down. We got to watch it.
She's awesome.
Ari Lennox TV. You know what I'm saying? Hilarious, beautiful. So I get on there and I'm like, what's up, Ari? Right. And then she's like, hey, Smoke. Hey, congrats. You did those. Blah, blah, blah. And then I just commented again, like, to the fans, like, hey, somebody tell Ari I got a song for her.
Yeah.
Fans went up. You know what I'm saying? Like, do the song with Smoke, right? So then she hit me like, hey, here's my contact info. And then, you know, we stayed in touch. Then she let me know when she got in the studio out here, invited me through. And, you know, I didn't know. I never assumed that something's going to happen. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people just do it to build. And I know everybody's working. So I go there. I play one record. Which was Black Habits Part 1, just to let her know something of what we got in the bag. And then she was like, then I played the next one, which is the one I had in mind for her. I was like, you know, this is what I had in mind. Let's see what happens. So I press play. She hears it all the way through, doesn't say a word. And then she's like, play it again. Then we play it again, doesn't say anything. Then she's like, play it again.
Uh-oh.
Then me and the engineer caught on, my boy Julio. Julio opens up Pro Tools, puts it on loop. And then after listening, she didn't do anything the first, like, four listens. Then she's like, play it again. And then she reaches for a pad and she starts going in.
Damn.
Right? And then 30 minutes later, she goes in the booth and, you know, her first lyrics are, you know, thighs mimic strawberries, ripe for the right picking, rolls for your Thanksgiving, 4C nappy, high C drinking. Like, I'm like,
I love her. Yeah. I love her.
Going off, she's so talented. Right? And ended off her verse. You know, with a challenge to me, like I was all on the poetic, like, you know, every scar, every line on your hips is only hieroglyphs. I'm reading your walls, you know, like talking poetically. But at the end of her verse, she's like, you know, let's get it. Like, she didn't say it like that.
Yeah, yeah.
She said, I can't say it on the radio. But and so I had to go again in the third verse and really talk my stuff, you know.
Isn't it crazy though how when you was first building that song, you didn't know what the next brick would, you know what I'm saying? You knew you had something special.
Exactly.
And then how God works or how the universe works, you know what I'm saying? That it came together. It says, like, not knowing what it's for.
Right.
But you knew it was for something.
Right, exactly.
And the way that it came together. Did it feel like the whole entire Black Habits project was like that? You know, sometimes I feel like it just writes itself.
Yes. I mean, there's so many moments because there were times where I went in with an intention and something completely different happened.
Mm-hmm.
And then some verses, when I'm done writing them, I look back and I listen to them and I'm like, dang, how did that come together? You know? And I think if you create from a place where it's like, the only thing I want to give people is my unique contribution to the creative world. Like, I don't want to give them something that I want to give them. I want to give them what's right.
Mm-hmm.
Then so many records come together like that, where it's like, okay, you know, you look up, like, you damn almost blacked out and then come to and then you look up and you like, I like this. You know what I'm saying? I'm humbled almost and blown away that this is what came out of that experience. So it's a lot of that on this project.
How many do you record before you say these are my X amount? How many's on there? 14, 16?
15 songs, 16 tracks with the intro.
How did you pick that?
Oh, man.
Well, how many do you record?
I probably have recorded at least 60, at least.
What's the process of elimination?
Well, we kind of make playlists as we go along. So it's like some were never on a playlist. Like,
right.
Like, hey, that's dope, but that's left.
Anyway,
you know what I'm saying? That ain't got nothing to do with what we're doing right now. And there are songs that never made the playlist that we're like, I can't wait to put that out. It's just not time for that. You know, I have songs, you know, I have songs with major features on there that aren't on there that we plan on putting out.
But that's lovely too, though, because you can shoot the flare in the air and light up everything and people come to it, or you could just take your time.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And I remember years ago, Luther Vandross said, I'd rather sell 15 million albums, 1 million, have 15 albums that sell 1 million mm-hmm. than one album that sells 15 million. So you're building, building, and you're building those blocks.
Absolutely.
You going to do Top of the Morning Live for us?
I'm going to do Top of the Morning Live.
I heard that. And we were talking about your Instagram followers.
Oh, my
Ani,
God.
You said his Instagram followers before like Rhythm and Flow was how many?
9 or 10.
9 or 10,000 before?
No, you must have looked. Bruh. You must have looked the day after.
Man.
That was probably the morning after it dropped, I had 9,000. The day before, it was 7,575 followers.
Where are you at now?
Ooh.
1.6 million.
That's crazy, bro.
Oh, you got that
I did ask, bro.
That's
like, that's crazy. And you know what I love about it, man, is that you didn't go out to get it. Mm-hmm. Like, we found you. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. We found you. We found a connection. We found a purpose. There was something in us that made us hit that like button. And for whatever the introduction was, like Chuck got 10 years. Mm-hmm. Some of us don't have the 10 years. Some of us got a little bit before, you know, Rhythm and Flow. And then others, we just like,
rhythm
you know,
flow.
So yeah. So it's like where you picked it up at. Where we picked you up is like where we picked you up. And there was something that pulled us towards you. You know what I'm saying? And
I'm still amazed by it. I'm not even going to front.
You could tell, though. And that's a good feeling, too.
Yeah.
And you felt the love from the city, too.
Yes.
I love that.
Yes. I mean, the real beauty of it is that we made the right connections prior to. So now it's because LA is a community, you know, that you have to tap into. If I came out of nowhere and then wanted to touch down with the 1500s and the Battle Cats and the Chuck Dizzles and show up here, then it would just be weird because it's like,
Who are you? You had a moment.
You know what I'm saying? But like, who are you? But all of those things were already in play. It was just that on the musical side, I had been in all these studios writing for other people.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? On the community side, I was in the classroom and I had the storefront where we was putting other artists on. Like, there were artists who came and performed at my storefront that from being there, they got calls to tour with so many people because people heard their voice. Musicians were touring and stuff. So
doing videos there too. I remember Terrence Martin and Ty Dolla Sign did a video there.
Exactly. Yeah, that's true. So Terrence and Ty Dolla Sign did a video in there. My friend Shalia Nicole did a video in there. So it's, you know, we did our due diligence and so now that it happened, the beauty is that we can just tap in with people we were already connected with.
The world has like an introduction. We have like an ownership like that we just like, that's ours. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And we just recently lost Kobe Bryant as well.
Man.
And we know that that's a blow for the world, but it's a different feeling for the city. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Mm. And what is that? Was there any fire in you from a like a Mamba mentality? Was there a fire in you to either create more, go harder, hug somebody, smile a little more? Like, what did that do for you?
I mean, after the tears, then that set in. You know what I'm saying? Like, nobody wants to pick up certain mantles. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
No, and it's not like I can fill his shoes by any means. I'm not a baller. You know what I'm saying? But I do understand that being from the city that embraced him and loved him and that he built, that you do just feel this sense of like, okay, we got to keep inspiring in the way that he did. We lost Nip shortly after the show.
Yeah.
You know, and that took my breath away because I was like, I knew that if we connected, I just knew it. I knew that if we connected, we could do something incredibly special for the city because he's Crenshaw and Slauson, and I'm Crenshaw and Manchester. Like, historically, that's like rivals, you know what I'm saying? But it's a mile away.
Yeah.
And I just knew that he would see, you know, what happened on the show and be like, hey, the kid from Englewood, that's worth connecting, you know what I'm saying? And so that just took my breath away. And London B asked me shortly after the show, like, who you want to work with now, Smokey? You know, we going to be able to work with who we want. And I was like, you know, Uncle Snoop and Nip.
Damn.
You know what I'm saying?
And you got the Snoop.
And I got the Snoop.
Rest in peace to Nip. And that right there, selfishly, there's times when I selfishly miss Nip.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And of course you mourn, and the same with Kobe, but it's selfish.
Selfish.
You know what I'm saying? And there's so much hurt and so much pain with it as well. But when we say, you know, the Mamba mentality, marathon continues, hashtag girl dad, there's so much that you say, you know what, man? We got to keep pushing forward as well.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And take those, you know, I told my son, I said, remember what this feels like. You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes we get some, you know, air in our nostrils and we let it go. Mm-hmm. Just remember what that feels like. Remember the promises you said to yourself. Remember what that low was, and not carry, but remember what it feels like and see what your journey becomes. Right. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
I'm ready for top of the morning, bro.
Okay, let's do it.
Are you ready for it as well?
I'm ready. You got the beat?
You thought I didn't? You know what I'm saying? Sure. All righty, let's go ahead and get into it, man. Top of the morning.
Yeah.
We got D-Smoke in Woo! The neighborhood.
We're going to jump.
Let's get it.
We're going to skip these curse words.
No, you do the curse words.
Do them?
Do the curse
y'all
words, bro.
For sure.
We're going to make it right.
Yes.
Do it, do it, do it.
Super. Good. Yeah, 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 yeah. Don't get it fucked up. It's love in here. Top of the morning looking up. Grateful for another year. Don't get this shit twisted, nigga, we with the business. But everything we do for our family and the kids, so don't get it fucked up. Yeah, it's love in here. Listen, love is patient and passionate pursuit. Say hello to the newest ambassador for truth. Nobody could do this all alone. So as I grow, I hope to secure another recruit. Danny Glover with the weapon, I'm lethal as ever. Blessed with natural ability, peaceful and clever. On the easel, I scribble sketches, put enemies over stretches. With the only weapon known to put trees in the desert, he's in a better space than he was less than a year ago. Reclining in the midst of violent opposition, I find it intriguing that people project what they fearing, yo. Responsibility to self says prioritize your health and let go of any fuck shit that's spiritual. But a musket is a must for these haters and trust. I ain't too elevated to go irate and leave them degraded. Laying face down over the pavement, don't get it fucked up. It's love in here. Top of the morning looking up. Grateful for another year. Don't get this shit twisted, nigga, we with the business. But everything we do for our family and the kids, so don't get it fucked up. It's love in here. Listen. The faint of heart say they don't believe it, cause it's easy to maneuver when you fake as a weave is. Greatness will leave you isolated in places where leeches can't even reach you, homie. They never teach you, only real feel the weight of they whole team. Closely knit, tightly stitched with strong seams. Take a risk, safety is points for the wrong team. Wait, scratch that, I'm talking abstract. Now let's look back at a time when I was laying my head down in my place of business. Didn't have any kitchen, no shower plates or dishes. Was making rent but could barely afford to pay attention. When opportunity knocks, some like Jehovah's Witness, you know it's written into your story just to answer that. That's when I call out to God, knowing she answer back. Used to think I was in charge, but I know better. So for now, we just enjoying the weather, nigga. Don't get it fucked up. It's love in here. Top of the morning looking up. Grateful for another year. Don't get this shit twisted, nigga, we with the business. But everything we do for our family and the kids, so don't get it fucked up. It's love in here. Yeah, listen. Paciente, amable, humilde, fuerte y nunca débil, pues. Libre pero disponible a ayudar cuando uno necesita. Cuidar a otros es la tarifa. Por nuestro tiempo mientras que estamos en esta tierra, hacemos con las manos lo que el cielo quiera. Cuando uno da control al viento, siempre vuela. Escápalo de abajo, so my nigga don't get it fucked up. It's love in here. Top of the morning looking up. Grateful for another year. Don't get this shit twisted, nigga, we with the business. But everything we do for our family and the kids, so don't get it fucked up. It's love in here. Super good.
Lord have mercy.
Hey, I like that
man,
one.
Man, top of the morning.
Top of the morning.
Come on, man. Yes. D-Smoke up in here, Big Boy's Big Neighborhood. It's love in here.
Hey,
Big Boy's Neighborhood, y'all.
Yes, sir.
Oh my gosh, man. You just killed that, bro.
Yes.
Thank you, bro.
Yeah, you were
Thank
saying you love the message in Spanish as well. Yes. I saw right there with her pen, like, oh, I got
right,
this.
I was trying to write, but there was a moment that caught my my attention that says, ayudar cuando uno necesita. You're talking about helping one another because I feel like so many people lack empathy and just like how much change that can create. Why was that important for you to speak about it and all the different messages that you're talking about in Top of the Morning?
Right. It's super important. My background, you know, I'm a teacher. My parents are like ministers, like literally. And I think it's just people get so caught up on ambition that it's like you lose sight of the fact that the real fulfillment is in what you can do with it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like all of this crazy stuff going on with me after the show, we flying everywhere. We making money now. We, you know, but what made me feel good yesterday is the fact that not because I was performing at the Clipper game halftime show in Staples Center. Right. It was the fact that I got my uncle, his son, my godbrother, his son, and my brother, his wife into there so they could have that moment where it's like, you know, these kids are teenagers and below. And one of them, you know, my nephew plays traveling basketball, you know, so it's like he's a serious baller. Like, I never was that serious at basketball.
Right,
you know?
I hear you.
I'm a killer in the backyard.
right.
For court, you know what I'm saying?
Keep it in the backyard.
So, but the fact that I was able to do that, that's where, like, people lose sight of how to do this and be fulfilled.
Yeah, man.
You know?
And you got to be have the blessing and be a blessing.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
It's so
nothing like being in a position where you understand the blessing and being a blessing to somebody else, man. And
absolutely.
Then your nephew would do that for someone.
Absolutely.
You can really change somebody's life.
Man, thank you for coming into the neighborhood. We'll see you next week.
Man, it's a pleasure. Every time. I'll be back next week.
Yeah, we'll see you next week, man, because we got to get married to the album, man. But just congratulations to you, man, on doing it your way. And I really want to see you win.
Thank you.
What I'm saying? You're such a good spirit, bro. Trust that, man. And thank you for coming into the neighborhood, man. And thank you for giving us your time.
Hey, thank you for having me.
D-Smoke
anytime,
in the neighborhood,
the
ladies
time.
And gentlemen. And by the time y'all see this, Black Habits, the album.
Yep.
Go pick it up.
You know what I'm saying?
Best believe that, man. It is definitely going down Big Boy's
Big
neighborhood.
Boy.
Hey.